Go ahead and turn with me to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, I'll try to be as brief as possible, but some of these things, it just takes some time to explain. Genesis chapter 1. Now, what's on my heart this morning is, you know, when I was in Sunday school as a little boy, most of you the same way, they taught me about the cross. They told me that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. And they did a good job at it. They told us about the cross. They told us about the death and burial and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. But then at the same time, if you try to think through it, you come up on a question. And the question is, why? Why did Jesus have to die on the cross for our sins? I mean, why didn't God just snap his finger and say, you're forgiven? You ever thought about it? It wouldn't hurt to think sometimes. Yeah. Well, most of the time it doesn't hurt to think. But why the cross? Why did the process have to be in place? Why did Jesus have to give his life? Amen. So that we could be born again, so that we could be washed in the blood, so that we could be here enjoying his presence. Amen. Fellowshipping one with another, enjoying all the blessings and the benefits that go along with serving him, and then get to go to heaven, and then after heaven get to be a participant in the new heaven and the new earth. Amen. Wow. Why did you see somebody had to pay for all that? But why? All right. I'm glad you asked. So what I want to talk to you about this morning is why the cross. Everybody say why.
Why?
All right. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And this, of course, is in the time period in which God is creating the earth and everything therein. In 26 verse, it says, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And God said, behold, I've given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree into which is the fruit of the tree yielding seed. To you it shall be meat for you. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Now, flip right over to the second chapter, and in the 15th verse. It says, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. Now go back up to that 15th verse, because I want you to see this. He said that he put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. That means to guard it. The same word for keep in the Hebrew is translated guard. It was Adam's responsibility to guard that garden. And he said, of every tree in the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Now in the Hebrew it doesn't say you shall surely die. In the Hebrew it says, dying you shall die. Now, dying, thou shalt die. He's talking about two deaths here. We know then that Adam did eat of the tree, but God said, the day that you eat of it, you'll die. Dying, thou shalt die. So what happened was, is he died spiritually. Later on, he died physically. Okay. Now, let's look at the third chapter real quick. And let's look at the... somebody took it out of my Bible. Okay. The ninth verse. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? Okay. We're talking about why the cross. Well, to understand why Jesus had to get down on the cross, you have to understand what happened in the Garden of Eden. God, who is spirit, created the planet Earth. And he created man from the earth so that man could rule for God in this earth. That's why his body had to come from the earth. He was created from the dust of the earth. But just being created from the dust of the earth didn't give him any dominion. He had to have some life in him. So God breathed himself. Not his breath. God breathed life. He breathed himself into Adam, and Adam became a living being. Now, God charged Adam after he had created all of creation. He said, now I'm putting you in charge of it. I want you to run the earth. You're going to have a particular place, a particular headquarters, which is going to be the garden. But I want you to run and to oversee the earth for me. I want you to take this earth and I want you to replenish it. I want you to multiply. I want you to cover this whole earth with human beings. So now what this is called when one nation goes to a territory and takes over a territory and begins to build a city or a country there in that territory is called colonization. You know, we were the 13 colonies of England. We belonged to England. We were under England rule because they colonized the eastern seaboard of the United States, okay? The Romans used colonization. See, most of the kingdoms up until this time, up until the Roman Empire, when they conquered a nation, they would take all the skilled people, the brilliant people, the productive people, they would bring them into their country to build up their country, okay? But see, Rome operated differently. They operated in colonization. What they did was when they conquered a place like Jerusalem, which they did, they sent people in there to teach them the language, to teach them the culture of Rome, so that colony becomes just like Rome. Are you following me now? Now see, this is what God was doing. He created the earth in his own likeness, his own image. So what he's doing, he is creating for himself another heaven. Except this heaven is not spiritual only. This heaven is made up of what we see and know to be earth today, okay? But then he placed Adam, he created Adam, he placed him there and he said, you rule, okay, you rule. And all he had to do, all Adam had to do was just do one thing, and that was not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, when the woman saw the tree that it was good, it was good. You know, the worst enemy of God is not evil or sin, it's good. Especially in the church setting, especially in the religious world. People do the good instead of the God. Amen. They see the tree and they see that it's good. And so we wind up doing good stuff and good things instead of God stuff and God things. Amen. But you know the story, and you know how that, and we don't know how much time elapsed here, but we do know this, that eventually Adam sinned. Let's talk about Adam's sin. It's important. Adam's sin was different than anybody else's sin. His sin, I used to hear preachers talk about the fact that it was a sin of high treason, and I didn't understand that, but now I see it very clearly. You understand that God had created another colony and put him in charge, but yet he that is in charge is directly under the authority of the one who sent him, of the one who placed him there, the one that gave his authority. So he's got to answer to God. God is still the ruler. God is still the God over Adam, even though Adam was his son. It was his creation, okay? So what happens is when God creates something and puts a person over that, when Adam did what God told him not to do, it was not just a sin like we know sin today. It was the sin of rebellion. Okay? Why? Because this is what he did. He rebelled against God. He rebelled against the kingdom that had established him as the head over the earth. See, it was rebellion. It was high treason. He turned on the person that had created him. He turned on the person that had given them the earth. Are you seeing it? So it was the sin of rebellion. It was the sin of high treason. But let's talk about now. He said, when the day that you eat thereof, you're going to die. Two deaths. See, Adam was spirit, soul, and body. And the word of God says that God is a spirit. That's what the word says. God is a spirit. Well, he created Adam from this earth. So Adam had a body from the earth. And then God himself breathed into that so that Adam became a living soul. Now you've got Adam who has a spirit, a soul, and a body. Now, the Bible says that God would come and visit with Adam in the cool of the day, and they would fellowship, they would talk, they would, I don't know, I'd love to have been a fly on the wall and heard what they talked about, amen? But they spent time together, amen? Because God's a spirit, and now Adam is a spirit. Did you know that you are a spirit? You're not your body. You're not your mind. Amen. You are a spirit. You have a spirit and you are a spirit and you have a soul and you live in a body. Amen. And so Adam was created spirit, soul, and body. Now, as long as his spirit ruled him, as long as his spirit was in charge, then he had fellowship with God. He could do the will of God. He walked with God. Amen. But now he said, in the day that you die, now this is what happened in that spiritual death. In the day that you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, dying thou shalt die. So here we go. We've got God. Come here, T. So we've got God and we've got Adam. And they're practically one because they have the same spirit. See, and so they're together and they're walking together and they're talking together. And I'm sure maybe that God is giving him further instruction like he did here about how to rule the earth and so forth. But all of a sudden when sin came, then remember now, God is a spirit. Now Adam is a spirit, just like you are a spirit. When sin entered, this is what happened. Adam went away from God. See, the separation came. God is still a spirit, but wait a minute. Adam is still a spirit also, but now Adam's spirit is not the same as God's spirit. See, you can be seated, T. So now Adam has a dead spirit because he died spiritually. Spiritual death does not mean that it's a section of life. In other words, Adam did not cease to be. Amen. It just meant that he was separated from God. There's three different deaths mentioned in the Bible. A spiritual death that we just talked about when a person is separated from God. Amen. And then there's the physical death when your spirit leaves your body. And then there's the second death, and that's when your spirit and soul are cast into the lake of fire. God calls that the second death. Amen. And so there's three kinds of death spoken of in the Bible. Dying, thou shalt die, spiritual death, and then physical death. You know that Adam would have never died. He wasn't created to die. He was created to live. And he never would have died if he had not sinned and his spirit had not been cut off from God. Now, what was it when his spirit was cut off from God? What did Adam lose? What was the loss that took place? Guess what? His spirit was cut off from God, so guess what? His purpose was lost. God put him on the earth for a purpose. He was there. He had a destiny. He had a reason to wake up every morning. He had a direction. He had guidance from God. He had a reason to live, see? And what happens is when people are lost, they don't know Jesus, then there's no way they can ever know what their purpose is because they're spiritually dead. Now, I can't imagine what it would be like, I'm just being honest with you, to get up in the morning, amen, with no purpose. Get up in the morning not knowing why I'm here on this earth. I mean, it's always bothered me. I mean, when I was a teenager, you've heard me say this before, my cousin and I sitting down on the side of the road one day, and we were talking, and we were just asking one another, why are we here? Because we're both miserable, depressed, you know. He was probably more depressed than I was. But anyway, we all came from the same depressed family. But anyway, we're sitting there, and why are we here? Why was I born? Was I just an accident? Is there any plan for my life? Is there any, why am I here on planet Earth? I got news for you today. Just as sure as Adam had a purpose, you have one. Just as sure as God gave Adam a purpose, he gave you one. But if your spirit is cut off from God, you can never fulfill that purpose because your purpose that God has put in you, it's going to flow out of your spirit, not your head, not your body, but out of your spirit. So here again, I can't imagine what it would be like to wake up in the morning, amen, with no direction, with no purpose, for no reason. Or see, a lot of people just live for themselves. They just wake up in the morning to see how, you know, how they go to work to try to make a living, or they go to work to make a lot of money because money's, you know, that's what they're all about. They go to work, you know, to provide for their children. And I used to think about the American dream. A lot of people live for the American dream. They do. They live to have a house. They live to have a couple of cars. They live to have a boat. They live to enjoy life. Not realizing, you know, that all they're doing is ministering to themselves. Amen. And you know what? There's going to always be times when you wake up and you say, I've got all this stuff and I've done all this stuff, but what good is it? I still don't have any sense of purpose. I sit still. And a lot of people don't come to that place until they're on their deathbed, unfortunately. Amen. So he lost his sense of purpose. The second thing that he lost God's fellowship. Now, that means that he lost his access to God. How, you know, and therefore he had access to everything that was in God. You know, if you're in fellowship with somebody, if T and I are in fellowship, then I have access to what's on the inside of him. I can draw what's on the inside of him. If I need every bit of the knowledge and wisdom and revelation and understanding, the experience and everything that he knows and everything that he's been through, I have access to that because I'm in communion with him. I'm in fellowship with him. And if I want to know that, then all I have to do is ask. I can draw it out. All right. So then think about it. When he lost fellowship with God, my goodness, now he lost God's wisdom. He lost God's knowledge. How would you like to have God's knowledge? Or anybody here? He lost his position of righteousness. He lost his hope. He lost his peace. He lost his joy. He lost everything when he became separated from God, when he experienced spiritual death. Now, another thing that happened when he sinned is his sin affected the whole earth, and it affected the human race until this day. Every one of us in this room, we have been affected by Adam's sin. Because when he sinned, he released a curse on this earth, And everybody, because of his spiritual death, the spiritual death of he and Eve, every person that they produced, and then their grandchildren and their great-grandchildren up until this day, all of them were born into spiritual death. You were born separated from God. Your spirit, when you were born, your spirit didn't come from God. Your spirit came from the first Adam, which was a sinning spirit, which was a rebellious spirit. And that's why you see it in a child from the day they're born. You see the rebellion. You see the control, the manipulation. They want everything they want right now. Amen. They don't care whether you get to sleep or not. They don't care if you got the money to buy milk. It never crosses their mind because they are all about themselves. They are selfish. They are rebellious. Why? Because that's the nature they were born with. And that's why Jesus said, you must be born again. The new birth is a new birth of the human spirit. Are you listening to me now? So all of these, and I could go on down the list of many things that happened from Adam's sin. But, you know, thank God there has to be a reversal of that curse, a reversal of that sin. And guess the only person that could ever redeem us was another Adam. The only person that could overcome the sin of the first Adam was another Adam. This is where a lot of theologians and scholars go nuts. Because they don't have the Holy Ghost as their teacher, and the only thing they've got to lean on is their own intellect, which is, you know what I'm saying? I mean, how would you like to have to live by people's intellect the rest of your life? Would you like to tell me the condition of this nation and of the world today because people are leaning to their own understanding? They are operating and running this world out of their intellect instead of out of their spirit, because their spirit is dead. God never wanted this earth run by a man's head. He wanted it to be run by the man's spirit that had been born again. Amen. So here's the important part, and I'm talking about why the cross. It was not God that got us in the mess. It was not God that planned all of this. What God planned, you saw his plan. His plan was that we rule this earth. Yes. Amen? Yes. And that we have authority over every creeping thing, creeping demons even. Amen? In this earth. Okay? So it was a man who sinned, and it was a man who brought spiritual death into the human race. It was a man. Matter of fact, we probably need to read real quickly in the book of Romans so that you can see it for yourself. Romans 5, starting in verse 12. Romans 5, 12. Remember, it was a man who got us into this mess, and it is a man that can get us out. See, that's hard on intellectuals' head. It's hard on their heads. Theologians, I'm talking about, scholars, I'm talking about. I watch them on the internet sometimes, and I just want to say, man, you need to talk to this high school dropout and let me teach you, because I didn't get a lot of teaching from man, but I got it from the Holy Ghost. Hello. All right, watch this. Now, I did get some teaching from men. Don't misunderstand me. Thank God for it. In verse 12, he says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world. Who's that man? And death. Death entered what? By sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So when you were born a sinner, because you had sinned in Adam. Did you get it? And so you're all born in sin. And he said, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Look at the 14th verse. Death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that is to come. Let's drop on down and let's look at verse 21. And as sin hath reigned unto death, and so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Okay, so then Adam's sin had to be, listen, sin, because God is righteous and he is the righteous judge of the earth, sin always has to be judged and punished. Somebody had to pay for Adam's sin. And it had to be a man. And that man is called the last Adam, or as you could say, the second Adam, and that is who? Jesus. Now, here's Adam, spirit, soul, and body. Spirit's cut off from God, spiritually dead, curses the earth. Everybody's born in spiritual death. But let's talk about him before, because it said here, before he sinned. Because, see, the word says that no man could sin after the similitude of Adam's transgression. That means nobody else can sin like Adam did. Adam's sin was rebellion and high treason because he rebelled against God and heaven. And God, he rebelled against God's government, God's kingdom. But here's the thing about Adam. Adam didn't have, like you and I, we're born in sin, so we had a dead nature to start with, but he didn't. His spirit, when he was created, he had the spirit. You and I were born, well, separated from God. He was created in right standing with God. He is created with a spirit like God. So he never knew spiritual death. Not only that, but he lived in a perfect world. A perfect world. Well, not only that, you know, how would he go about sinning anyway? He couldn't commit adultery. Wasn't but one woman, and that was his wife. Amen. He couldn't steal. Everything belonged to him. Amen. I mean, he couldn't sin. The only thing that Adam could have possibly done to sin was to rebel against God. Okay. And that's what he did. Now, when Jesus came along, because he is the last Adam, and he is the one that is going to reverse this curse and bring us back out of spiritual death into spiritual life. Let's talk about Jesus. Jesus was a man, which means he had a spirit, a soul, and a body. I used to think that his spirit was God, but it wasn't. It couldn't be because he was a man. That means he had a spirit, a soul, and a body. The difference between Jesus coming into this earth as a human being and you and I is the fact that when he was born in the flesh, you know, they laid him in the manger and so forth and so on. When that happened, he came into this earth with a spirit just like Adam had, a spirit that was alive unto God. His spirit, when he was born, his spirit was alive unto God. When you were born, ours was dead. Amen. And because our spirit was dead, it affected our mind, it affected our thinking, it affected our emotions, it affected our body. Amen. Well, when Jesus came along, now you remember Jesus was born of a virgin. That had to be so. Now, I've always been told that, you know, that the bloodline or the blood type or whatever comes from the man. That's, and that makes sense to me. And I don't know all the signs of this, but I do know this, that a woman already has blood. All right. Well, when she conceives, hello. Then there has to be some blood that is transferred. Amen, for that child to have blood, Okay. So that comes from the male. A woman already has her own blood. She can't have babies. She can't create anything. And so, see, why is Jesus' blood called precious blood? Because his blood was not like anybody else's blood, because Mary was overshadowed by the Holy Ghost and Jesus was conceived by the Holy Ghost. He did not have a natural physical daddy like you and I have. So guess what? That means Jesus was born spiritual life. His spirit was not God. Please, now this is where the scholars go crazy again. Matter of fact, well, I won't go into that. Anyway, he was a spirit, soul, and body. He never ceased to be God. Jesus was God. Let's clarify that. But Jesus never did one thing, not even the slightest thing, in this earth as God. The Godward side of him never, ever was manifested as long as he was in his physical body in this earth. Because the authority of the earth is with human beings, people who have a spirit, soul, and a body. So Jesus operated and did everything in this earth as a man. That's why he was tempted in the wilderness.
That's right.
I've had people ask me, could he really sin? Well, of course he could. Adam did.
That's right.
Amen. Jesus was a man. He was very man, 100% man, but he's 100% God. Amen. God wanted the people of the earth redeemed because he said in Acts chapter 3, there's going to be a restoration of all things. Okay? But God did not act in Jesus as God. Jesus became a man, the seed of Abraham. See? And so that's why everything he did as a man. That's why when he died as a man. Hello? All right? Here's Jesus. He doesn't have a dead spirit. He's never had to contend with that. He doesn't know what that's like. You see what I'm saying? He didn't know. And so therefore, now the difference between Adam and Jesus was that Jesus was born into a hostile environment. He was born into an environment that was against God. But he still had a spirit that was alive unto God, which means because of his spirit, he was able to operate out of his spirit. And so therefore he thought like God. And he had emotions like God. And he had a body, but he had his body from this earth. Hello? But that body, if he had been God, he'd never got hungry, but he did get hungry. He did have to rest. God wouldn't have to rest. God wouldn't have to have food to eat and water to drink. Hello? All right. Amen. So what's got to happen here? In other words, for this things to be turned around, there has to be a reversal. In other words, somebody's got to bring it back to its original state. See, in Acts chapter 3, it says that there's going to be a restoration or a restitution of all things. What are the all things? And well, he goes on and talks about Moses, and he wrote the first five books of the Bible. The restitution of all things is actually bringing this whole earth and the people of this earth back to the same place that Adam was in the beginning. That's the restitution of all things. I know you want to live in heaven forever, but you're not. I know you sing about it. You want to die and go to heaven? Well, you do right now. But see, we don't have the new earth yet. So you just hang out in heaven until the new earth, until the plan of God is consummated. Then we go and we rule and reign with Christ in the new earth. What kind of earth? One just like Adam had.
Right.
Amen. Amen. All right. So Jesus then, see, Jesus had an advantage over us. But the Bible says he was tempted in all points, such as we are, yet without sin. Did you know that Jesus then was tempted with the same temptation that Adam was, and yet he didn't sin? That's why, listen to me very carefully, that's why when Adam sinned and he went into spiritual death, he had to stay there, amen, until God killed skins and so forth and so animals, because blood had to be shed. Now, I don't know to this day exactly where Adam is. Maybe you know, I don't. But anyway, I can tell you this. Adam never did come back from spiritual death. he went into spiritual death, but we have no record of where he came out. Now, here's the difference. When Jesus, the Bible says that Jesus became sin, he that knew no sin, he that knew no sin became sin. He didn't sin. See, Adam sinned, and he went into spiritual death and couldn't come back. But guess what? Jesus took the sin of Adam. He that knew no sin, or you could say it, he that never sinned became sin. In other words, he became just like the first Adam after the fall. Do you remember this? Do you remember that the Lord said when Adam had sinned and he came back to fellowship with him? Do you remember this? He said, Adam, where art thou? Now see, I never understood that until the Holy Ghost showed me. Where art thou, Adam? Does God know everything? He's omniscient, right? So when we talk about a physical thing, do we not understand that God knows everything? He knows when a sparrow falls to the ground. He knows how many hairs on your head. Amen. So then, did he naturally and physically, as we would say, did he know where Adam was? But see, this is what he said. Adam, where art thou? Meaning that Adam, through spiritual death, had gone to a place called spiritual death where God could not go. So, because there's no death in God. See? God can't go into spiritual death. God didn't die on the cross. Hello out there. So he said, Adam, where art thou? In other words, you've gone somewhere now that I can't fellowship with you anymore. You've gone somewhere that I can't even come to where you are to get you. I can't come down there where you are in spiritual death and fellowship with you, and you draw on me, and I give you instructions anymore, and we hang out and fellowship. Where have you gone? You went somewhere that I can't go. Now, this is the thing. If Adam went somewhere into spiritual death, and God wants to get mankind and get Adam out of spiritual death. He's gone into spiritual death. How am I going to get him out of there? I'm God. I can't go there because he's a man and he's spiritually dead. If I'm going to get him out of spiritual death and darkness, I'm going to have to send somebody down there to get him. I can't go. I'm God. I got to go. If I'm going to get him who represents the entire human race, if I'm going to get the human race out of sin, out of spiritual death, I got to send somebody down in there to get him out. To take spiritual death, or to take the human race by the hand and lead them out. But it's going to have to be a special man. It can't be any man, because all of us die. And all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So the only way I can send somebody in there and make sure that they come back is they got to be sinless. They got to be spotless. They got to be pure. They got to be perfect. And that's why it took a long time for God to set up the whole thing to where Jesus could come along. Remember, he's still God. Are you listening to me? But he became a man, a perfect man. And that's why when he hung on the cross, he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? You know why he said that? He said that because at that point, his spirit became separated from God's spirit, just like Adam's did. He went into spiritual death, but the clincher is he came back. he came back. Amen. And when he came back, he brought you and me with him.
Yes.
Amen. Now, all we got to do is trust in what he did. Amen. And we come out with him. Now, Why the cross? Why the cross? Because you see, now if you were God and you had a son that was rebellious and you had to send somebody in there to get him. See, it was God that punished Jesus. It was God. What's he doing when he punishes Jesus? Sin has to be punished. And Jesus became sin. And when he became sin, God had to punish that sin that came from Adam. That's why Jesus had to die spiritually before he could ever die physically. Now, you want to send this video to the scholars? They'll go crazy over that one. I've had people get irate. I've had pastors. I heard one guy came out, and he didn't normally stutter, but you said something tonight. I pastored 25 years, and you said, I said, what'd I say? You said Jesus died spiritually. Became separated from God. Pastor, 25 years and still that ignorant. Some ignorance you have to work at. You can't even get, you got to have devils to help you because, see, you can't get that ignorant on your own. Amen. Here again, it wasn't God that died on the cross. It wasn't God that went into spiritual death. If God could go into spiritual death, he'd have done it with Adam. Amen. And after he sinned in the garden, there had to be a man that went in there. Amen. But he had to be a perfect man. That's why, because Jesus knew no sin, he had no sin. That's why when he went into spiritual death, he could come back. Now, we're still talking about why the cross, right? Why did Jesus have to die on the cross? Well, we see what. Now, if you were God and you had to send somebody into spiritual death, somebody had to die to pay for the sins of the world, how would you have done it? Would you put him in a firing squad? You know, throw him out of an airplane? I mean, how would you have done it? Well, see, he gives you a picture of this in the Old Testament under the law. Under the law, if a father had a son who rebelled, and he rebelled, and you couldn't get him to, you know, you couldn't talk to him, you couldn't get him to listen to you, he stayed in rebellion. The word says that rebellious son is to be taken outside the city and hanged on a tree. See, Jesus was the rebellious son who was taken out and hanged on a tree. Not his rebellion, Adam's rebellion. See, the father had to crucify his son because of his son's rebellion. Jesus became sin. He became rebellion. Now that's why he was taken outside of the city and was hung on a tree. That's why that precious blood had to flow down into this earth so that you and I would not have to live our life in spiritual death, not having a purpose, not having peace, not having joy, not having life. But just simply, because Jesus became sin. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 3, he said, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Jesus became cursed with Adam's curse, with the curse of the law as well. He became cursed. And he hung on a tree because of Adam's rebellion. And guess what? Your sin had to be paid for. That sin nature that you were born with, it had to be dealt with. Well, guess what? I didn't have to be delivered to the Romans. I didn't have to be beaten with a cat of nine tails. I didn't have to have a blind, a sack or something put over my head and be slapped and beat and taunted and tell, well, you're a real prophet. Tell us who's hitting you now. I didn't have to be hung on a cross with nails drove through each hand and through my feet. I didn't have to have a spear stuck in my side. I deserved it because I was born in the first Adam. I had the sin of the first Adam. I deserved it. But guess what? I had somebody that did all that for me. I had somebody that took my place for me. I had somebody that died spiritually for me that I might spiritually be alive. He traded, or I was able to because of what he did. I could trade my sin for his righteousness, my sickness and my disease for his healing. I can trade my poverty and my lack for his riches. Everything that is deficient in my life, Jesus, through his death, burial, and resurrection, provided for me. It wasn't a big deal because, listen to me, the most horrifying and horrible thing that Jesus experienced was not the nails in the hands and not the beating of the back. Guess what? A lot of other people experienced that as well. He had people all around him being crucified by the Romans because the Romans hated the Jews and they hated anybody that rebelled against Rome. And that was the accusation against Jesus. That wasn't it, because if that alone was what saved us, then guess what? We could have been saved by any of those people that were crucified. But the worst thing that Jesus ever had to experience was that separation from the Father. When he became sin for us and he was separated from the Father for that season, see, that was the true pain and suffering that Jesus experienced for you and me. He became dead that we might become alive. And you know, this is so simple, you would have to sit and wonder why anybody anywhere wouldn't take advantage of this. But my goodness, now I don't have to die and be buried and resurrected, although I will be, amen, but not to get my salvation, amen. But all I got to do is believe he did. I said, all I got to do is believe that he did, that he died, that he was buried, that he died spiritually, and that he rose from the dead. Amen. I want to hear he's alive again. I just got to hear it one more time. Everybody say he's alive. You know, Muhammad is dead. Allah is a demon. Amen. But our Jesus is alive. Now, you know, see, here's the thing. Everybody's got any sense at all or any history knowledge knows that Jesus lived on this earth. Even the Muslims believe that he lived, but that he was a prophet, but not on the level of Muhammad. Jehovah's Witnesses believe that Jesus lived. The Mormons believe that Jesus lived. Hello. But see, you have to believe that Jesus was the Son of God and that he bled and died for you. Not that he was just a prophet or an apostle or evangelist or pastor or teacher, but that he came in God's stead, because God couldn't come because he had to be a man. So God sent his Son. He sent his Son. Listen to me very carefully. If you're here this morning and you've never been born again, being born again is not just believing in Jesus. Because the Bible says, again, the devils believe and tremble. Just believing that he existed, no. That word believe means to acknowledge, to depend on, to rely on, to trust in. If that's not where your faith is this morning, you need to receive Jesus, because this morning you can be born again. It's very simple, just with your faith. If you're here this morning and you have rebelled against God in any life or any sin that you're living deliberately outside of God is a rebellion. And so then you need to, what we call, rededicate or come back into fellowship with God. Now you understand this. Adam didn't have to go to church. He didn't have to get born again. He didn't have to get filled with the Holy Ghost and speak with tongues. He didn't have to have the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. Because his spirit was so alive unto God, his spirit ruled. But now for your spirit and my spirit to rule us, it takes all of that and more. But God's purpose is the same, and that is that you and I do our part. You're here not by accident, but on purpose and by purpose. You are here to fill out your part in the restitution of all things, to help with God's plan to come to pass in the new heaven and new earth. We all have a place, and we all have a purpose. We all have a destiny. Doesn't mean that we have to fulfill it, but you get an opportunity. So if you need prayer this morning, we'll pray for you. Go ahead and stand up, and they're going to sing. Hallelujah, Jesus.